tonight. Open your mouth and bless the name of Jesus. And make the Lord a strong tower. Come on. Open your mouth and praise Him. Open your mouth and praise
Him. I will bless the Lord.
Come on, church, can you sing it tonight?
Oh, my soul.
To address the thought, World War II.
World War II. You're looking at me like, how, where is he going with that? You'll see in a few moments. Let us look unto the Lord. Can you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, we need your touch tonight. We need your anointing. We need your spirit that allows preaching to be easy. Oh God, help us and rest upon us afresh, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Lord, give us clarity of speech. Give us the ability to convey the understanding that you've given us tonight. In the name of Jesus, help this word, oh God, to loose shackles, to break chains, to break fetters tonight. In the name of Jesus. I don't know what warfare your people may have faced, even just getting here tonight. Whatever the battle they have been going through in their family, in that household, oh God. Lord, satisfy them with your word tonight. In the name of Jesus. Give them clarity and confirmation that you are there with them even in the struggle. That you are there with them even in the issue that they're going through on tonight. Lord, this day, do a sudden work among us. Do a sudden manifestation among us. In the name of Jesus. Lord, satisfy our spirits. Inspire us again in the name of Jesus. We trust you to deliver. We trust you to set free. In Jesus' name. And even if there should be some soul that does not know you, Lord, save me by your power divine tonight in the name of Jesus. Trouble the waters of baptism, O God. Give some of the Holy Ghost, I pray. In the mighty name of Jesus. And even tonight, we'll be careful to give your name the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name. Somebody put those hands together and give God a praise tonight. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated tonight. World War II. What is war? We often generalize it to be a dispute between dynamic parties, particularly over land and resources. We even associate it with the rights of certain individuals or demographics to certain entities and functions. Often we consider it as merely a manifestation of strength and heroism. And though it is, it can only be so if those that are fighting in the war and on the front lines are abreast and aware of what the fight is over and understand what it takes to win and to overcome the given enemy that is at hand. War, particularly, is defined as a distinct and particular armed conflict. Stay with me tonight. It's interesting to me how research emphasizes the word particular, because we find that though it may be armed, it's ineffective without reasoning. And so the definition stresses to us that in order to win the army, in order to be in a legit battle, in a legit war, there has to be a particular purpose. In order to go to battle, there must be a significantly threatening opposition that stimulates the need for physical contact. And I would like to submit to the saints tonight that a mere dislike of character is not sufficient reasoning for warfare. Simply not liking someone because sister so-and-so or deacon or brother so-and-so didn't speak to you or didn't come to your event is not enough reasoning or sufficient reasoning for you to go to warfare with folk, especially when they're in the same army as you are. Y'all ain't talking to me tonight. Oh, what a tragedy it is to be at war and in opposition against folk that are in the same army, on the same front lines as you, and going against the same true adversary as you are. So you've got to be cognizant of those that are warring with you in the spirit, those that are in the household of faith, and not be too quick to capitalize or to major in the minors of life. Y'all ain't talking. And becoming distracted by unnecessary opposition. For God is calling for us to realign our focus tonight. For I hear the Bible saying that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but rather they are mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds. I wish you would help me and tell somebody this is a spiritual thing. Oh yes, this battle that we're fighting, this war that we are waging is a spiritual war. It's not something that deals with just flesh and blood and character and personality conflict and presence issues with each other. But rather, this is something that is supernatural. This is something that is beyond the time realm, but it's rather a warfare.
there that is prevailing in the eternal. Somebody shout amen. And so we find here that in every legitimate war that has passed in time, there is a premise of true threat that has prevailed. The world wars that were waged in the past were a result of three particular factors, and they were the overthrowing of government, the pursuit or the control of nations and their people or their leadership and government, and also for the sake of obtaining land and resources. Look at the Civil War that was waged in the 1860s. We find that it was waged as a product of one race trying to assume superiority, trying to take the authority over another race for the sake of obtaining their possessions, obtaining the things that they had rights to, stealing their rights from them. And the thing is, it takes a toll, not just physically, but it takes a toll emotionally. And that was the premise and the idea behind the war that was waged. Here in America, the recent war we engaged in was a war on terror for the sake of obtaining the resources, the land and the resources that we cherished and held so true to our nation. And so that was the two factors, the resources also at the obtaining of government, but then there's also trying to take the morale of the culture that you're warring against out. And I would submit to you tonight that we as a church are fighting the same tone of war here. We're not just dealing with the economic issues and the physical issues of our nation, but tonight the devil is using the same tactics to take the church by storm. He's using the same tactics to fight particularly our generation. He wants to take the rights that God gave us before the foundation of the earth. Secondly, he wants to get above God. Look at what Lucifer said from the beginning. He said, if I could just lift my throne above God, if I can lift my throne above the Most High, then I'll take over. That's what he wants to do. He's been attempting to do these things. He's been attempting to lift his throne above God, take the ultimate government and the divine government of the spiritual and the supernatural under control. He's trying to take the wealth and riches and the anointing and the call that God has deposited in his church. He's trying to take it for himself. He's trying to take the calling and the power that God has invested. Why? Not because he is simply the prince of the power of the air, but just like anyone who is being replaced, he's jealous that his role has been revealed. You're hearing me preach tonight. Tell somebody, you're a replacement to the adversary. Oh yes, the role that the enemy once filled in heaven. He was one of the most cherished beings in glory, and now his place had a vacancy in heaven. And because there was a vacancy in heaven, Jesus created a mechanism called salvation. He created a mechanism called grace. He created a mechanism called mercy to redeem his church that we would feel the vacancy of heaven. And so is there anybody in the church tonight that can get excited that God has saved you to fill the vacancy? Somebody clap those hands and shout hallelujah to God. Hallelujah. So as it is in the natural, so shall it be in the spirit. We as a church and even more as a generation are at warfare. Hear me in the spirit that God is preparing us. God is situating us for the enemy's attacks. That's why we cannot be ignorant of his devices. God is allowing the enemy to attack his people. Why? Because God wants to make, can he trust you with the glory? Glory to God. He wants to make, can I trust you with what I want to reveal in my people? That's why Paul said, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. But in order for the glory to be revealed in us, in order for us to really obtain what is to be not compared, we must be aware that God has to trust us with struggle. God has to trust us with warfare. God, he trusts us with his power, but his power can't go unused. You're right here in the church. God's power can't go without utilization. And the only way to exercise the power of God
storm clouds and strong winds and handle the oppositions of life correctly. We get Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. They didn't do anything wrong. They were in the midst of ministry. But somehow they got locked up because the woman with divination was cast out. And the magistrates didn't like the fact that they were men of God. They got thrown into the prison, but I find it to be that the reason why God allowed them to be thrown into the prison and stretched there is because that was the only way that he could trust them with elevation. Let me help a priest tonight. And so I submit to somebody tonight, you say life doesn't seem to go in my favor enough. Everything that I touch seems to fail. Everything that I seem to deal with seems to go south. Everything in my family seems to be in turmoil. God says the reason why I'm allowed it is because I have a greater purpose for your life. I have a greater purpose for your family. I have a greater purpose to bring out of your house. Be not dismayed. Whatever be tired, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of lullabies, God will take care of you. Is there anybody that can lift your hands and testify that my faith looks up to me? Oh, Lamb of Calvary, Lord, I trust you to make everything all right. Somebody shout hallelujah. I said somebody shout hallelujah tonight. I promise I won't be long before you hear. And so Satan sees that his role has been refilled by the redeemed church of the living God. And because this adversary is and will be replaced, he's come to wreak havoc in the same churches of God's people. He's come to create terror, if you will, among the very elect of God. He's come to deter you from your God-given rights. But tonight I'm on assignment from the Lord to empower the church of God tonight, that we are created to counterattack on the very principalities of the underworld. We're created to counterattack the very strongholds that fight the church of God. The strongholds on the mind. The strongholds on the emotions. The strongholds on your feelings. The strongholds on your perception. We come to counterattack the very plot of the enemy with the Holy Ghost. For when there's power in the Holy Ghost to tread on the scorpions, to tread on the serpents, and anything that comes cannot harm you. That's why Isaiah said it. He said, no weapon that's formed against me shall be able to prosper. And every tongue that rises up in judgment, thou shalt condemn. You have the authority of the Holy Ghost to activate your survival. You have the authority through the Holy Ghost to activate your victory. For thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Can I find a church that'll jump on your feet? Lift your hands and thank God for the victory. Open your mouth and give God a prayer. We've been equipped to bring terror back to the gates of hell. But here Jesus said, upon this rock, that rock is him, that rock is his name, that rock is his authority, the most stable thing in time and eternity. Upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I come to make it personal, because each and every one of us are the church
soul. And so let me briefly consider the text for a moment. We find Paul here urging this young church here at Ephesus to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We must be cognizant, church of God, of two factors here in this verse. The first factor is that there is an agent for strength in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that agent of strength is called faith. We know what faith is in its most original form. We find it second in the Hebrew written. That faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. We know the rewards of faith. But we've got to understand that it's more than just an avenue of incentives toward God. But rather faith is not something that we must apply to the thing that's most stable in the eternal. Our faith must be predicated on the finished work at Calvary. Our faith must be predicated in the cross of Christ. No faith can be predicated in some ideology of modern times. No faith can be based in what you hear at Megafest or hear on television. But your faith must be expressed and based in the crucified Christ and the finished work at Calvary. For it is in the finished work that you find rest for your soul. That's why here in Hebrews saying that there remaineth a rest for the people of God. The rest is in the embracing of the finished work at Calvary. And so in other words, in order to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, you've got to embrace Calvary. In order to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, you've got to assert yourself in the fact that this same Jesus who created heaven, that is one with the Father, he came down, manifested himself in flesh. He put on a body of corruption. He put on a body of mortality. He put on a body of transgressions. He put on a body of sin and shame. And he went to Calvary with your issue. He went to Calvary with your struggle. He went to Calvary with your stronghold. He went to Calvary with your bondage. And since he went to Calvary, he died in your stead. Now hear the song saying, Jesus went to Calvary to say, like you and me. They hung him high, they stretched him wide. The power of his might. In consideration of such, we must understand that God has put this power that he used to raise from the dead, this power that he used to go back into glory, and this power that will enable him to catch up the saints. He's put this power at our disposal. He did not save us, children of God, just to have power enough to speak in eloquent the Lion. He said, you come to me with a sword and a spear.
Beware.
I want you to tell somebody else. Beware. God said,
Ghost. You've offered the sign. Now I want you to pray in the Spirit. I want you to pray in the Holy Ghost. I want you to pray a prayer of warfare. When I'm making the prayer, I want you to pray with me in Jesus' name. Are you ready? Every hand connected. Every hand connected. This is not a matter of program. This is not a time for you to focus on what's around you. I need you to intercede on everything that's been back in your lifetime. This Lord does not have age limit. Old, young, season, new, whoever you are, you'll get a fight tonight. And I begin to pray. I want you to open your mouth to the top of your voice. I want you to lift your voice in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus.
the adversary fights us every single second.
Every
moment of our lives. As long as the saints are on the earth, the enemy is going to be at his prime attack. So tonight, if there's anybody, I'm going to give the mic back over to Pastor, but if there's anybody that needs to be saved tonight, I can't let this go without you being saved. If you don't have the Holy Ghost, I need you to stay at this altar. If you're saying, well, I need a refilling of the Holy Ghost, stay at this altar. If you need to be baptized in Jesus' name, this is your moment. I'm going to get the altar call right now. Can I get the ministers to come?